there. Welcome to the Cloud Security Podcast by Google. Thanks for joining us today. Your hosts here are myself, Timothy Peacock, the Senior Product Manager for Threat Detection here at Google Cloud, and Anton Chuvakin, a reformed analyst and senior staff in Google Cloud's Office of the CISO. You can find and subscribe to this podcast wherever you get your podcasts, as well as at our website, cloud.google.com/podcasts. If you enjoy our content and want it delivered to you piping hot every Monday, please do hit that subscribe button. You can follow the show, argue with your hosts, and the rest of the Cloud Security Podcast listeners on LinkedIn. Today is a special episode because the content was also available as a live stream on our LinkedIn. And listeners, if you want to be part of the future live streams, do follow the page and subscribe so you can get the invites for the future live streams. It's also available on YouTube. Anton, we're talking about something that led me to have an epiphany. And without getting too deep into that, what did you think about the show?
I think it was an amazing show and an amazing epiphany, even though I had a minor fear because I have to kind of, not to use the quick intro psychoanalysis, but from many, many years ago, I have a slight...
Wait, who are you psychoanalyzing, me or you?
Me, no, myself.
Oh, okay, good.
So it's,
go ahead.
I have a slight fear of policy.
Ah, that's not surprising.
It's a little bit surprising for a sort of a supposed security professional to have a policy phobia. It's a little unhealthy, right? So, but the reason why I had and probably still have to an extent fear of policies is because I've seen too many paper policies that then don't get implemented in metal.
Yeah.
So in essence, the policies that scream, I have this piece of paper, but I'm really not doing it. Hi, lawyers, I'm negligent. That type of stuff. I have a very intense fear of that. And so when I hear policies code, I get somewhat excited. I think maybe it would make policy automatically be real. But who knows?
Who knows? Well, listeners, if you want to know, stay tuned. Let's turn things over to today's guest. Today, we have the distinct pleasure of being joined by Dominic Richter, like the earthquake, founder and head of product at Mondoo. Dom, thank you for joining us. Really excited about this topic because it's one that's been getting more and more of my time lately. So this is like professionally timely for me. So often on the podcast, you know, Anton and I talk about some random thing. I'm like, I guess that'll be relevant maybe. But here it really is. So I want to talk about, well, eventually we're going to talk about policy as code. But first, let's just start with policy. For people who are maybe new to cloud or work on some other part of cloud, what is policy? Is that the same as a control? What's the gap? What's the gap between a policy and a guardrail? Like there's a lot of terms here. How do we think crisply about what this means?
By the way, if you start to Google some of those terms, you're going to open a hole. And that is deep because these terms are in politics and they're in healthcare and they're everywhere else. But all right, so let's talk about security policy real quick. So security policy is essentially all the rules and the expectations that you have and how an organization really wants to maintain its security. That's essentially what a policy is. So it sets the expectations on the security, and it generally helps us to meet regulatory requirements. So if you have things like PCI in order to process credit cards, or ISO, SOC 2, HIPAA to do healthcare information, a policy helps us to get to those regulatory requirements, right? So it's very technical. Then you mentioned controls. So what are controls? So when we see controls, it's the specific things that we want to do in order to control risk, right? That's where the term comes from.
Mm-hmm.
So we're trying to control risk, and the specific things that we're doing, they are defined in controls. So like establishing traffic encryption or making sure that everybody has secure access that is enforced.
Got it.
Those are controls. They are typically the body of policies. Now, the last piece you mentioned were guardrails. So what are guardrails? Well, out there in traffic, I can tell you what a guardrail is because it's going to keep my car on the road, especially on these like very, very treacherous mountain passes. And
that's the hope.
Fingers crossed. Depends on your speed, of course.
But you don't literally physically use guardrails to keep your car on the road, hopefully. Guardrail is, okay, some people do, but like normally, that's not a normal operation for a guardrail, is to literally keep your car on the road.
That's true. Yeah, it makes for some funny YouTube videos, I'll tell you that. But in IT, so if we take it over, right, like guardrails do a very similar thing. They limit behavior. So it's a combination of both testing, where the policy can essentially be expressed as a test, or all the controls that I have within that are essentially a set of tests. But the guardrail also enforces behavior. So it's going to say, yeah, like within this realm, you are free to move. You're free to behave. So to a degree, we allow for decisions to be made within a certain realm. Now, of course, if your guardrails become really, really, really tight, you don't get a lot of other behavior. Like, that's more of a straitjacket then.
That actually makes sense. And I think you did manage to answer four profound questions crisply. So this, I guess, is a one of the hallmark of a great guest, actually. Yes, it's actually a really good point.
You're off to a good start.
So I want to jump to policy as code. And to me, it's, I think most of the cloud, even cloud tourists, not just cloud natives, I think would know that there's infrastructure as code. But here we are talking about policy as code. And because you just explained policy, I'm kind of curious. Are we talking about policy as code for security policy, or is it policy as code for all policies?
So we're going to be talking about all policies here. Security, of course, is one of the biggest fields that this applies to. But let me actually take half a step back and like look at infrastructure as code first, because it's going to explain to us like where policy as code is coming from and why it's so good. So infrastructure as code, right? Over a decade ago now, almost two decades ago, we're getting there. Gosh, we're getting old.
Speak for yourself.
Infrastructure.
No, not just him.
Oh, ouch.
No, sorry. It's, I think, for both of us. Yeah.
So we started with infrastructure as code because we really wanted to describe the infrastructure that we wanted to roll out in a way that is easy to reproduce, easy to repeat, easy to scale out. Right? Like infrastructure deployments used to be really, really complex, especially when you did them manually. We called them like fat fingering the machines and trying to change the settings, make sure that it behaves. And then infrastructure as code came over and suddenly you were able to express all these complex things. You were able to scale them out. So a decade ago, actually, we worked on infrastructure as code in the telco space. And we looked at it and I came over from the security department and I was looking at all this automation we're doing there. And I was looking at the way that I was checking the security requirements. And it was like two different worlds had suddenly collided. Like I went in there with halfway manual checks, trying to see if most of them were sufficiently implemented. And that's where I noticed, no, we need a different approach. And this is where policy as code started for me, because we started to enforce our security policies in a way that was very, very similar to the way that we were rolling out infrastructure as code, in the hope, of course, right, that it was going to give us all the same advantages, be scalable, be repeatable, be testable. And then, of course, I still have to take the results that are coming out of this and putting it into the old world, which is the documents, the spreadsheets, and the emails that you want to have.
Yeah, I mean, I'm annoyed even listening to this, not because the speech is annoying, but I'm like, I'm suddenly immersed in this environment, the visions of PCI compliance come to my mind, and I'm already kind of anxious, not in a good way. So I think that it's very useful. Apparently, you painted a juicy enough picture so that I'm annoyed by that world.
It is. It used to be a very manual process. And I will tell you this too, as a security tester, so I used to be in pen testing and security testing, and in that world, one of the things that gave me anxiety was that I was there to certify the environment, and yet with these very manual approaches that I was taking, or even with these black box tools, I kind of had to trust that they do their job, or I may lose my job. Mm-hmm. I hope the results kind of match what I expect there, and I hope that my other team isn't hiding the really bad parts, the skeletons, from me, because they're trying to get a release out, and they have pressure, and they need to meet some kind of deadline or like an event, right, that we often have. And that's when you're trying to get through the security audits. So it's not an easy process that you're in. And yet it's so vital that you get the security things right, because we have seen the rise of ransomware and we've seen how easy it is to fail these audits and really be in a lot of trouble because of it. So to get back to policy as code, so we said then, okay, let's start to express what we had in these documents as a kind of codified way so that we can scale that out as well. And we wanted to make sure that it meets our requirements, because not everything out there looks the same. Like a lot of the things are very repeatable up to like 90% or 95%. And then there's always a few things that are different. And I've had people ask me over the years, like, why not just like use the latest version of TLS, the highest encryption that is there. Like,
why not? Say, like, what could go wrong?
And then 4 months later, you're like, oh, that's why it never worked.
Yeah, exactly. Because you're probably going to lose 40% of your customers if you do that, because they don't support those levels of TLS or those ciphers that you're trying to enforce. I've had CISOs ask me, why can't I just like give me the button that just changes the settings in production? And turns out production, like what we call the Omnis production, is actually like this organism that we're trying to keep alive that is quite fickle and not as easy to manage, right? Like we've invented all these technologies like Kubernetes in order to make these scale out more and be easier to change. But ultimately, like, you're introducing change to an environment that is powering your business that may cost you millions, if not billions, if it goes down. And so that easy button is not quite as easy as you think, but we can use the principles that we have on infrastructure as code in order to enforce better security policies. Like, we can use the same foundations. We just have to marry the process.
That actually makes sense.
What does that look like in practice? Who actually does this? Because I'm trying to imagine hiring somebody to translate where we started, regulatory compliance, all the way down to this. And I can't imagine finding a single person or even team of people who can do that. So how do you make that happen?
Let me ask you a more cynical version of that. In the old world, that annoying world, humans would write policy. But in this case, it seems like you need engineers.
Yeah. So first of all,
okay, nobody's laughing. Fine.
So the humans, you still have the humans, by the way, because the policy ultimately, like, at some point, you need to come up with that policy. In today's world, oftentimes we come up with a paper policy first, then we translate it into security policy. I think in the future, we're going to have them go hand in hand. Like, when we figure out what the best practices for policy are, we're going to codify it from the beginning, so that you have the paper policy that you as a human can read. Like, I'm the interface for that. And then you have the policy as code, which interfaces with all my technology that I can then roll out and scale. So who writes this, right? And the traditional answer to this, especially at the beginning of the DevOps movement, was, well, you got to have your engineers. Very simple. Like, software engineers, you got to hire them, you got to write them. So we tried to do that in the last couple of years, ever since policy as code has been rising. And we ran into a bit of a problem there. Because the software engineers, in a lot of cases, and I really love my teams and the people that work in this field, but we are, in many cases, not security experts. So we understand software, we understand engineering. Like, I put a lot of time into being a really great engineer, but there is an entire world of security context that these policies require that is oftentimes missing. And so you continue with this disconnect that you have between your engineering team that will hopefully implement your policy and your security team that actually knows what the hell's going on, right? So what we found is that there is an emerging discipline of security engineers which combine these two principles together. They don't have to go crazy on software engineering, right? Like, they don't need to write C code or anything.
Wait. Sorry for interrupting. So policy as code is simply the unholy marriage of infrastructure as code with policy?
Yes.
Oh, we're done.
I don't think we're done yet.
Okay, we're not quite done.
we're getting there. This is the fun part, right? Like, we thought too, I remember actually a decade ago, we just put it into code and we're like, all right, cool. This is the best thing ever. Let's just roll it out everywhere. And turns out that's not as easy because, as you mentioned, policies need to be maintained. Changes will need to be introduced. And so who does that? And so security engineers are probably one of the best audiences to maintain these policies because they are close enough to the technology and close enough to the security as well. So they have a mixture of both. But as we'll see a little bit later on too, I hope we can dive into this, a lot of the frameworks that we have had so far were very, very complex. Like, they were hard to maintain. And even I, as a decades-long software engineer, have had difficulties reading and maintaining many of these policies. And that's been one of the reasons why the adoption of policy as code had been a little bit slow over the course of the years.
Wait a second. So what is the main challenge here? Then it's kind of a good question.
The main challenge, I can imagine about a half dozen challenges here.
Yeah. But like, there's probably the challenge of some sort, right?
Yeah, the biggest one is probably maintaining these policies and effectively rolling them into your environments. So it comes from the underlying complexity of this. You have a lot of different technologies that you're writing these rules for, a lot of different technologies that you need to understand, especially when you're putting to put guardrails in place. And you want to make sure that this is married with your platform engineering team so that they can actually use and deploy this as well. The closer you bring security and platform engineering, the better your overall security posture will be, because it's ultimately your engineering teams that will enforce the changes. It's not the security teams. It comes out of the engineering teams. And for example, security engineers have been our ways of embedding more security into these engineering teams and introducing more of these practices that actually make a difference. So it's not just about reporting anymore. For almost two decades now, the focus in security has been all about reporting. Just get me the reports. I need to know what's going on. And we're shifting right now over to a space where it's more about actually making an impact and a change to that security report, to that security posture, to actually get to a better state.
So let me pick at that, because I was talking to somebody recently who listens to the show, And they mentioned having these enormous environments, you know, tens of thousands of projects where each project is a production instance for a customer. They talked about the process to roll out a new guardrail. A single new guardrail to be applied was a multi-month, multi-person effort. So how do we possibly help people with that kind of scale and that kind of rollout challenge? Is there an answer to that?
Yes, there is.
Oh, good.
So
I just run the damn code. What do you want to know?
This is why Anton's not an SRE.
How hard can it be? Actually, that question, by the way, how hard can it be? Like, that's where I switched from security over to platform engineering, because years ago when we rolled out that first cloud environment, I was on the security side. I looked at it and I was like, how hard can it be to just fix it and deploy these things? And here we are over a decade later. And yeah, that's the answer to your question too, is that policy as code, again, like, allows us to do all these things. However, it depends on the specific technology that you use and how easy it is to make changes to it and how easy it is to roll it out. And of course, the rollout speed that you just mentioned is way too slow, especially if you have environments where you're trying to enforce recent changes that came in. Like, let's say, for instance, an auditor came in, you need to make some change to your security policy, you need to roll that out. If that takes you multiple months, then that will probably also take some engineering time, which ultimately is detrimental for policy as code too. So how can we get closer to where infrastructure as code is, right? Like, infrastructure as code, I remember in the early days even, it allowed us to make changes to environments multiple times a day. And this is to thousands of systems that are out there. Like, that was the promise that we came in with. I actually view policy as code in the same way. But what is important here is that you treat the policy the same way that you treat the infrastructure as code, which is the same way you treat other code. The policy itself needs to be continuously tested. So you need to have test environments that actually spin up real infrastructure that you can run the policy against to make sure that the policy, first of all, behaves in the way that you expect it to. Like, when we develop our own policies that are codified, all of them, we regularly test them with green tests, red tests, basically a mixture of environments to make sure that the policy in itself behaves correctly.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And then you get to the next step, which is...
So that reduces risk quite a bit, right? Like, that reduces the risk
of
doing something wrong with the policy, and then have all the fears of all the security people and all the SREs and DevOps people materialize. Like, oh, you're going to run this stuff and everything blows up, right?
It's a start on that path, but production environments are always pets. They're never cattle.
Okay. It starts you on that journey.
Yes.
So how do you... What's the rest of the journey then?
So the rest of the journey is, so when you look at how we put the policy into effect, so there's usually three major categories where policies come into effect. Of course, the first one is production. That one is the easiest, right? Like, you test out what is in production. And typically when you're at that stage, when it throws an alert, you go back to the operations and to an updated rollout, especially in the world of cattle that we live a little bit more in today. So I make the changes in the pipeline through the deployments, and that's coming into production. Again, I'm not making the changes necessarily to one or two systems in my production environment. So that's the first one. And the second one is the CI/CD pipeline. Of course, when the change goes through the pipeline, you can and you should introduce policies there in order to make sure that it meets security requirements. But here's already where an interesting thing happens. When it doesn't meet it, what exactly happens to your pipeline? Do you stop it? Do you stop it based on the threshold? Or do you let it roll? And this is one of the reasons why some of these changes to policies also take so long. So when you introduce them to these pipelines, if they stop the pipelines, then, oh, that is on top of all the other changes that people are trying to introduce. And of course, that slows things down. The last area where you apply policies is typically in the developers' workstations, in their test environments, early on. I like it if I have like my local coding environment and I can already execute a lot of this policy so that I don't have to wait for a lengthy CI/CD run until I see that a change is bad. The sooner I see it, the better.
And lengthy in this case still means minutes, right? It's not like you're going to call an auditor over the phone and invite him over and next quarter he shows up. So some of the stuff is lengthy by cloud standards. It's just as a useful kind of a wedge about, like, it takes a while. So what do you mean, like 10 minutes? And the same task would have taken you, you know, maybe not 10 months, but like months possibly, right? So this is kind of, we're in a much better world here.
Yeah, we are. The way that I like to do this is, to be frank, like, if I treat it as code, if I treat my own policy as code, I treat it like any other piece of code, which is through lengthy testing and integration testing, especially end-to-end as well, then I have higher levels of assurances so that when I roll it out, and I do my careful incremental rollouts, I feel a lot safer with them. And so when it comes to policy as code, I actually believe in cycle time just as much as in all regular coding practices. Cycle time is incredibly important because it's going to influence how quick the rest of your platform engineering works and how quick your security practices can be enforced.
Actually, sorry for an idiotic question. Cycle time?
I always ask the question in my software engineering practices, how long does it take me for a change to be rolled out? Mm-hmm. For it to be introduced in the testing, in the different stages of the pipeline, when do I see that a change is bad, for example? Some changes I can see very, very quickly that they're bad and great, they're getting thrown back and I can make the updates. Some changes will take me very, very long because, for instance, you need to spin up an end-to-end system, which you cannot do with every change ad hoc because it might take an hour to spin it up in today's world, right? And so cycle time to me has always been that end-to-end measure of how long does it take me to introduce this change in a codified environment? So either with policy, either with infrastructure, or just with regular applications I'm trying to introduce.
Okay, that does make sense. So to bring it to more practical reality, of course, you work for a company called Mondoo and you have a tool called cnspec, right? And you promise to assess the entire infrastructure security and compliance, right? So to me, I also want to learn more about even the assessment part, because to me, this is, has been very difficult, even for cloud environments. People, you know, seem to be lacking a tool that just assesses security and compliance for the entire environment. So how did you make it work?
Let me actually rephrase. I think there have been a lot of tools, in fact, out there, even in cloud environments, but they're all very fractured.
Yes.
So it's that there is a tool for your cloud configurations. There is a tool for your containers. There's a tool for your images. There's a tool for your operating systems in the different types. Windows has its own tools and Linux has its own tools. There's tools for Kubernetes.
It's a lot of tools.
Yeah, that's a lot of tools. And then you need to make a decision on what's the best tool and you hope that it's still maintained over the course of time. And then you need to somehow switch all that information together. So we came out of this world. We had originally started the first policy as code engine called InSpec in 2015. And what we realized is that, you know, that came out of that practice of rolling out the first cloud networks and was great for operating systems and was great to an extent for the modern infrastructure that we were striving towards. But we noticed that there were some things that it lacked that we could never do. And this motivated Mondoo. So with Mondoo, with cnspec, especially with the open source tool that we created, was what if we created a security testing framework, a policy as code framework that did two things specifically. One, I wanted it to be as technology independent as possible so that when I have new technologies come out, I can bolt them into this and go through the same level of testing and expressions and everything that I know. So once I have the knowledge about how to express these policies and write these security rules, I want to make sure that we can add any new technology, even if we don't even know what's going to come up in 5 years, to it and be ready for that. And at the same time, also have it catch, you know, older technologies that people still have in their environments. There's very, very mixed environments out there, a lot of brownfield. We didn't just want to go like, well, screw you, not getting any of the fancy new tools. You will have to wait until you migrate. That's bad for security because hackers don't care. I don't care. Your auditors don't care. They're going to say, well, why isn't this configured correctly? And so with cnspec, we really tried to remedy that. So that was the first thing. The second thing was that having created the first policy as code engine out there and seeing many of the others in the years following it, I noticed this problem that I mentioned earlier that a lot of your engineers aren't security people and a lot of your security people aren't engineers. And if I require everyone to have like these high levels of software engineering, like write Go code and dive deep into Python code and so on, then I'm going to lose them on that, because that's not where the strengths are in the security space. And again, with the software engineers, their strengths aren't in the security. So with cnspec especially, we wanted to create something that security engineers, security practitioners could use, and not just engineers, so that it's more accessible.
So wait, it's a low-code policy as code.
That's right.
I want that.
Yes, it's low-code policy as code. That's the best way to express it.
It's a codeless policy as code. What's, it's like my dream. I always wanted that. I don't have to code, but I have code.
Anton is hurting me right now, listeners. You can't see me if you're listening to the podcast, but I'm in physical pain here. So I want to pick at this a little bit, Dom. There's a bunch of other security testing tools out there, Sentinel, OPA, Rego. You've got a new standard now with MQL. Insert the XKCD cartoon here. Do we really need another standard?
If you look at an average team that is using one of these frameworks. I don't want to bash on any one of them because there's great people working on them too, and they do the job great that they do, right? Like, for instance, we have ourselves used OPA for certain authorization pieces. Of course, that's what it was developed for. It's great for that. But I've seen teams use it for security policy. I've seen them try to implement it. And when you get to like 10 rules after a course of 6 months of working on it, something is wrong. When I look at your security policy and I can't even understand what it does, like when I open up your policy as code and I don't understand what it does because it's calling some weird Go function in the background.
Maybe it's written in Fortran or something.
If we go even deeper, then
I'm hurting Tim. Now I'm really hurting Tim. Sorry, Tim.
That was a lot of pain. Yeah, that one I felt too. So when you have that, then of course, you know, that's not the behavior that we want. And so why did we come up with another one? Well, it was because we actually wanted to help security engineers express the roles, share these roles, create a community around these roles, and not tie it into just any one technology so that it becomes scalable. And so a lot of the things that we did with MQL was this desire of giving somebody access to it that is not a programmer in its own right. They know how to use Python. They are dangerous with Python. But right, like I'm not a software engineer as such. And that was the entire desire behind MQL. I sometimes describe it as, well, this is GraphQL plus extras. And then still people in security space will look at me like, wait, GraphQL? And then I basically say, well, it's just like JSON plus a few added expressions. That's where we wanted to get to.
Okay. So this is actually fascinating. And I think it's not just for making fun of low-code policy as code, but as a genuine change about how we do things, including in the environments that aren't greenfield. But then the question comes up, how do you measure, like, are you doing well? So is there, can you give us any kind of brief overview on like, how do you measure progress on this? Can I be 100% policy as code compliant, or how else would I go about it?
Yeah.
Coverage?
So you start, first of all, by rolling out a policy as code framework that you have. So the first question is, how long does it take me to roll that out to all of the technologies that I have? So coverage over time, right? So cloud networks, Kubernetes, VMs, and then your services that you're running, SaaS services and so on. So how long does it take me to roll it out? That's the first thing. That's the initial step. Next step is, I talked a lot about cycle time before. So how quick can I implement new rules or make changes to existing rules and then roll them out? Cycle time is important for this one too. And then the last one, and this is the one that my heart's beating for the most and where I'm seeing the biggest change in the next decade, is outcomes, i.e., does it change our posture over time? Does it help us to increase the overall security stance that we have? Does it help these teams to work better together?
As measured by number of incidents or as measured by, I mean, has it improved security is of course a good metric, but how do you measure that?
So for example, by the number of findings that you have, by the speed at which you're tackling vulnerabilities that are coming out, by the speed in which you're helping your auditors, right, to deliver proof. I still have so many people that have to take screenshots of the friggin' applications that they have because of some SaaS services and give that over to audit.
No, that's hurting me.
Yeah.
Everybody, actually.
That one.
Bad. Everybody just cringed.
That one is a lot of pain. And so audit speed, too, matters because you're keeping someone in your organization busy doing basically busy work instead of doing the things that they are really, really good at, just to help the auditors make sure that things are the way that they run. And so, yeah, audit speed matters, evidence collection matters, how much effort and cost do you put into rolling out your security practices, and then ultimately also outages and best practices. Mm. So I mentioned in the very, very beginning, one of your first questions was, is this just about security? And no, it's not. We've actually seen these security policies and this policy as code being rolled out for best practices in the DevOps world, in the platform engineering world, because this will prevent certain outages that are happening. Like, for instance, if your network equipment suddenly goes down because somebody didn't follow these best practices. And so, yeah, I think it's not just security anymore. I think it's many of these other fields.
So it comes full circle, which I really love.
Yeah, same here.
And yeah. Okay. So as much as Anton and I are enjoying this slash being in pain, we're at the time of the thing where we have to say it's time for the closing questions. So do you have one tip for helping people with their policies code adoption? And two, do you have recommended reading? And the recommended reading can be anything. We recently had somebody suggest Mary Oliver, which I loved.
So the first tip for your policy as code is work with your platform engineering teams when you roll something like this out. We had the ownership question before. You know, is it just security that owns this? Is the platform engineering that owns this? You ultimately want to, like, security will likely still remain the driver when it comes to what are these controls that I have in there? What are the security checks that I'm trying to follow? But it is your platform engineering teams that you really want to adopt this and roll this out broadly. So that is the first one. Like, be the collaboration you want to see, basically. Mm-hmm. Recommended reading for this goes pretty broad, of course. Like, I highly encourage anyone to follow us with Mondoo and cnspec and all the things that we're doing there for many of the reasons that I already mentioned. But other reading material that's out there is if you start to dive into modern infrastructure as code and the practices that they deploy. Look at what makes infrastructure as code tick. Look at what makes it work really, really well. And try to translate that, especially into the security space, into the practices that you deploy.
Awesome.
Perfect. This was hugely useful, actually. So,
and it inspired a lively discussion on the live stream. Everybody on the live stream, thank you for joining us. Thank you for the discussion in the comments. Dom, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me.
And now we are at time. Thank you very much for listening and, of course, for subscribing. You can find this podcast at Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever else you get your podcasts. Also, you can find us at our website, cloud.withgoogle.com/cloudsecurity/podcast. Please subscribe so that you don't miss episodes. You can follow us on Twitter, twitter.com/cloudsecpodcast. Your hosts are also on Twitter at @Anton_Chuvaykin and _TeamPico. Tweet at us, email us, argue with us, and if you like or hate what we hear, we can invite you to the next episode. See you on the next Cloud Security Podcast episode.